language is a powerful programming language. However, it did have one significant limitation. It lacked support for object-oriented programming. Object-oriented programming allows smart programmers like you to organize code into reusable units called classes. Recognizing this need for object-oriented programming support, Bjarne Straustrup, a Danish computer scientist, decided to extend the capabilities of the C language. Straustrup initially referred to this new language as C with classes. In 1983, the language underwent a significant transformation leading to its new name, C++. Now, let's explore the basics of C++ language in just 10 minutes. This is a basic C++ program that prints Hello World in the terminal. A C++ program ends with .cpp extension. Let's break this down. The first line is hashtag include iostream. This hashtag include tells the compiler to include all the code from the iostream header file, which provides object like cout to print the data in the terminal. Every C++ program should have a main function, just like in C. A function is declared by specifying the return type of the function, which is int in this case, since we are returning 0 at the end. Then the name of the function, followed by any arguments in parentheses, and finally the body of the function in curly brackets. When I saw this line for the first time, I was like, what type of sorcery is this? How are we passing data to the cout object without using parentheses? And what is the purpose of this left shift operator? Also, what does the double colon mean? If you have the same questions, don't worry, I will explain it to you. With the help of this line, we are printing Hello World in the terminal. In C++, this operator is called the insertion operator when used with the cout. It is used to format the data according to its data type and then send it to the cout object, which displays it in the terminal. The basic function of this operator is to shift bits to the left, but this behavior can be changed through the concept of operator overloading in C++. Operator overloading allows you to give different meanings to operator, but since this is the beginner's video, we won't go into detail about this operator overloading. Now, if you include multiple libraries in your code, there might be another cout object somewhere in those libraries. So how will your compiler know which cout object to use? It knows by using this scope resolution operator. When we write std double colon cout, we are telling the compiler to use the cout object from the std namespace. The std namespace is available through the iostream header file. You might be familiar with classes and functions, but what about namespaces? A namespace is a feature in C++ that allows you to group related code together to avoid naming conflicts. Think of it like this. A single line of code is a statement. A group of statements creates a function, and a group of functions and variables create a class. Similarly, a collection of different classes, objects, functions, and variables forms a namespace. In this code, we are telling the compiler to use the cout object from the std namespace using the scope resolution operator. Finally, the return 0 statement indicates that the program has finished successfully. Declaring variables in C++ is same like C language. First, write the data type, then the variable name and the semicolon. If you want to initialize it at the same time, you can do it too, using the assignment operator. Like here, I have assigned the value 10 to the lucky number variable. These are some of the data types in C++ that you can use when declaring variables. Here, I have used int, which is used to store whole numbers like 1, 2, 3, etc. There are total 95 keywords in C++. Keywords are reserved words in programming language. These are those 95 keywords. It is important not to use these as variable names, function names, etc. Now, to print the value of the variable, you can use cout object, then our insertion operator and the variable name. Let's run this to see the output. 10 is printed, but it is not printed on the new line. That is because we are not ending our first line of the Hello World. To end a line, we can insert one more object after Hello World, that is endl object, using the insertion operator. Now, 10 will be printed on the new line. Instead of using the cout again to print the lucky number, you can use the insertion operator after the endl object and then write the variable name. This reduces repetition and our output is still the same. Since we are only using the std namespace in our code, we can simplify the process of specifying the namespace by using the line using namespace std. This line lets the compiler know that we will be using the std namespace throughout the code, allowing us to directly use cout and endl object without having to mention the namespace every time. What about taking input from the user? How can we do that? For that, we have cin object, again from the std namespace. So first we need to type cin, then this extraction operator, and then the variable in which we are going to save the input from the user. So let's save it in lucky number variable. And now let's ask user to enter their lucky number using cout, and then we will take input using cin, and then we will print number using cout. Let's see if this works or not. Let the lucky number be 8. And we got our output. Your lucky number is 8. So this is how input and output works in C++. What about loops? In C++, we have three types of loop. The first one is the while loop. To create a while loop, simply write while followed by a condition in parentheses like a is less than 5. And then enclose the code you want to use within these curly brackets. So let's print the value of a using cout. And then we will increase the value of a by 1 using this increment operator. In a while loop, the condition is checked before each iteration. And if it is true, the loop will keep running until the condition becomes false. That is why we see 0 to 4 printed in terminal. After that, the value becomes 5, the condition becomes false, and while loop is terminated. Next up is do while loop. With this loop, you start by writing do and then the code within curly brackets. After that, you add while followed by a condition in parentheses. In a do while loop, the code is executed at least once regardless of the condition. Then the condition is checked, and if it is false, the loop won't run again. This do while loop is useful when you want to execute a block of code first without checking the condition. Last but not least, we have the for loop. To create a for loop, you start with the keyword for and then provide the initialization of a control variable like int I equals 0 followed by a semicolon. Next, you specify the condition such as I is less than 5. The loop will continue as long as this condition is true. Then, if we want to increment or decrement our control variable, like I++ will increase its value by 1 after every successful execution of the for loop. As compared to other loop, for loop provides you more control over the loop. Here, we are printing the value of I till it is less than 5 using the for loop. Now, let's move on to the conditional statements in C++. The first one is the if statement. To write an if statement, use the if keyword followed by a condition in parentheses. Then enclose the code to be executed if the condition is true within curly brackets. For example, if Twitter is greater than Threads, we print Twitter 1 and we see it in our terminal. If the condition is false, we can add an else statement to execute alternative code such as printing Threads 1. Let's increase the value of Threads, and now Threads 1 is printed. By adding multiple conditions using the else if keyword, we can handle various cases. For example, if Twitter is equal to Threads, we can print both are stealing data. Let's equal these values, and now both are stealing data is printed in our terminal. Another useful conditional statement is the switch statement. It allows you to select which statements to execute from a group of options. Let's say we have a variable number of likes initialized to 10. We can use the switch statement with different cases, such as case 10 followed by the statements for that case. You can have multiple cases and even a default case that will be executed if none of the cases match. Since the value was 10, the code in case 10 was executed and we see this output. Now, let's explore functions by creating one to add two numbers. To declare a function, specify the return data type followed by the function name and the parameters in parentheses. In our case, we will take two numbers as parameters and store them in integer variables. Then, we enclose the code within curly brackets and use the return keyword to return the sum. To call this function and save the result of the addition, we can declare one variable. Then we can assign the value returned by the function to that variable and provide the two numbers as arguments. Finally, we can print the value of the addition. And there you have it. In our terminal, we see addition of those two numbers. But what if you want to add some notes or explanations in your code for yourself or other developers? That's where comments come in. Comments are lines of text that are ignored by the compiler and are for human understanding only. There are two types of comments in C++. Single line comments. These comments start with double forward slash and continue until the end of the line. They are used to add short explanations or notes about the specific lines of code. Next is multi-line comments. These comments start with forward slash star and end with star slash. They can span multiple lines and are used for longer explanations of the code. By using comments effectively, you can enhance the clarity and maintainability of your code. At last, to compile your C++ program, type G++, then your file name, for example, helloworld.cpp, and then dash o, then the name you want for the output file, for example, hello, and hit enter. This will create an executable file. Type dot slash and then the output file name to run your C++ program. So that's it for C++ in 10 minutes.